So, Nomi, up to this point, do we have it right? Have we kind of laid out what it is that this big banking scam, this big investment banking scam, this big insurance industry scam has been?
Yeah, we do. I mean, it's a lot of different pieces. So when you know, like you said before the break, when you actually kind of read about it, or you kind of gloss over because there's CDOs and ABS and all these like different words and terms. But the bottom line is, you know, basically the banks made a lot of money by repackaging and selling a lot of loans. And what they created on the back of those loans, that was the toxic stuff, much more so than the loans themselves. If it had just been this whole crash about foreclosures and about individuals, we could have fixed this from a federal government standpoint with a tiny, tiny fraction.
Now, explain that. We could have bought the mortgages, put these people back in their homes. Is that what you're saying?
Well, exactly, because first of all, that $1.4 trillion worth of just subprime mortgages, that doesn't mean all those homes went to zero, and it doesn't mean everybody foreclosed. I mean, basically less than a third actually of that value was lost. So we're talking about, you know, a half a trillion to $700 billion. Now we've spent, the government has spent or made available to the banking industry in its entirety, first of all, $700 billion worth of TARP money, but much, much more than that. The Federal Reserve at one point had on $8 trillion worth of different loan, you know, facilities and ways that banks could get really, really cheap funding, which is not available to ordinary citizens at 0 to 0.25% interest in return for some of the toxic assets that the bank still had on their books.
Let me ask you something. Just put this in perspective. $300 billion in fees changed hands with just this structured asset banking scam.
Right.
$300 billion. And your position is, if all of this is if this position that the banking industry's taken, well, look, we were just the victim of greedy, slovenly, unreliable, poor people that never should have bought the house. And we're a victim of that. If that's true, then where did all this other this $13 trillion go? It didn't go towards putting these people back in the houses. It went to the bankers, didn't it?
Well, it absolutely went to the bankers, and as we see now, with a whole lot of federal subsidy to have, you know, renovated the crash that happened from it, banks and certain banks are back to making record profits and paying out record bonuses. So it definitely went to the bankers. I mean, it's kind of like blaming that last drop of rain for a deluge or a tsunami that like ransacks a beach. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's like, yeah, there's a relationship between some of those subprime loans to the crisis that happened, but the crisis was created by the banks who made fees and leveraged and traded and did not care about the risk they were taking, nor had any accountability. And that's why individuals can't find the pieces of paper in a lot of instances that they are being foreclosed and need to find, because that piece of paper could have gone through 5, 10, 15, 20, you know, 50 different incarnations. Some of these CDOs actually are predicated on other pieces of themselves in other deals. I mean, it's completely crazy.
Describe the term leverage. When we're talking about leverage in the setting that you're talking about, describe how leverage works. What is it? How does it work?
Well, it's like this. If you look at leverage just from an individual standpoint, a simple example, you know, I go to Vegas, I have a dollar in my pocket, I want to play blackjack, and I turn to you and I say, you know what, I have a dollar, but I need 100, so could you loan me 99? Mm-hmm. And you say, okay. And then, you know what, you go to the guy next to you and you say, you know what, I just loaned this person 99, I need 199. And they're like, okay. And this kind of goes on. And then what happens is, you know, I lose.
Yeah.
And not only do I not have the dollar that I started with anymore, I certainly cannot pay you back the 99 and so forth down the line. And leverage is basically putting a little bit on the table and borrowing a whole lot more that if you win, you can make a lot of money out of, and these banks did for a number of years.
And that's what your book really does show, how this is just nothing more than pure, you know, speculative gambling. That's all it is. And so you lose at the craps table with your dollar that you started with, and then everybody down the line loses as well, including those banks that the taxpayers had to bail out because they were gambling with our money.
Right, and they chose to be in that game, because ultimately, what do banks get money from? They get money from deposits. They get money from the very loans that they're betting on, because that's where some of their interest payments are coming in. So it's all very, very circular.
Okay, so Nomi, let me back up just a little bit. When these slovenly, unreliable, idiotic, stupid, poor people were trying to buy a house, The banks loved them, didn't they? I mean, because what you actually had, you had a whole different level of people, of business that was going after these people who had the audacity to actually want to own their home. You know, so the banks encouraged that. I mean, that's where this really breaks down. You see, the banks went out of their way to make sure that they could get as many stupid poor people in front of them as they possibly could back then.
Well, absolutely, because the dumb poor people also had the misfortune of being at the bottom of this chain where they could be charged really significantly high interest rates. And they couldn't even say, like, well, you know what, it shouldn't be 12%. It shouldn't be 13%. That's insane. That's extravagant. They were so, you know, they're being pushed with all of these deals. And what the banks were saying was, that's great. We found someone
right.
that we can get 12%
right.
or 13% out of, rather than 5%. We get to make another 8%.
Not only that, Nomi, they had more stuff to bundle. They
yep.
had more paper to bundle up into these fraudulent securities in CDOs and put them out on the market. Is that correct?
Well, exactly. The amount of subprime loans tripled during that period from the period beforehand, simply because that was the place the banks were turning to basically bottom fishing to find these loans to put into this massive pyramid of other types of securities on top of them. And that's why they structured assets on top of these loans at triple the rate that it had been before that.
Right. And you had a whole industry that literally in some neighborhoods were going door to door, knocking on doors, saying, you own your home, would you like to get a loan on it? I mean, that's how outrageous it was in some areas. And the banks knew that. The banks wanted this next tier of hustlers to do that, to go after poor people. The banks encouraged that because the banks couldn't make money unless they had this big bag of CDOs and to sell. Is that basically correct?
Exactly. They call it appetite on Wall Street. They call it having an appetite for this type of product. And the big banks, and those are the Wall Street banks, and they don't go door to door. They sort of like keep their distance away from these like slovenly people. They have different lender banks at the bottom of that chain, or individual brokers going door to door, so they don't have to kind of touch it.
Oh, but they know what's going on.
Oh, they know what's going on. The implication is, hey, we will buy your junky loan, so go make junky loans.
Yeah, yeah. Hush, hush. Go make junky loans.
Exactly.
Nomi, this is great stuff. You know, it makes me want to go back and read all your other books, Other People's Money and Jacked. This is really good stuff. You know, it is a problem in the sense that people, they read these details sometimes and they zone out. But it really is not that complicated, is it?
No, it's not. And even creating these securities isn't complicated. I mean, it's much more complicated. For example, I created them while I was on Wall Street. I have to admit, change a tire, but I can make a CDO. And so it's really not that complicated. You know, anyone, if they, you know, had a little bit of time and weren't bored by the notion, could do it. But it's really how this whole idea was spun, that you know, banks kind of used to allow themselves to distance themselves from the fact that they really created their own crisis.
Nomi Prins, it's been fun to talk to you about a complicated issue.
Thank you so much.
Thanks a lot.
Bye-bye. Bye.